So in today's session, we are going to discuss the modeling capability of Diana for determining the cPage point from a cPage phase problem. Before the live demo, I will give you a short presentation with some general information. I will try to be concise. And after that, we will do the live modeling all together, and hopefully we come to some results. So let me hide. So let's start with this presentation. Generally speaking, cPage defines a slow escape of liquid or gas through a porous media, or let's say small holes. The cPage phase is the boundary between the saturated flow field and the atmosphere, or between a saturated flow field and the stream channel, where the water is free to exit from the subsurface. Studying cPage phases is a central component of many geotechnical or hydrogeological studies. Commonly, cPage phases occur in unconfined groundwater flows. The major difficulty in cPage analysis is to find the position of the phreatic surface, or in other words, the top of the groundwater flow. This is what we will try to achieve in today's case studies, and hopefully we will be successful. If we consider a fluid particle, as depicted on the figure in the top right corner of this slide, the energy of this particle is made of kinetic energy due to the velocity, strain energy due to the pressure, and the potential energy due to the elevation Z. Sorry, with respect to a certain datum. If we express this energy in a unit of length, we get basically the total head, which is the sum of the velocity head, the pressure head, and the elevation head. And they are named HV, HP, and HE. The pressure head depends on water pressure in soil pores, and the elevation head depends on the location of the datum Z. The cPage flow is a slow process, so because of this, we can assume that the velocity head is null, and then the total head is basically the sum of the pressure head and the elevation head. The relation between the pressure head HP in meter and the pore water pressure U in kilopascal can be expressed as follows. The driving force of groundwater flow is induced by the total head difference delta H. It's important to mention that cPage flow in soil always flows from a higher total head to a lower total head. Darcy's law characterizes the flow rate in a porous medium. And here is the equation in case of a 1D problem, where Q is the flow rate, usually expressed in cubic meter per second. KH is the hydraulic conductivity or coefficient of permeability in meter per second. I is basically the gradient, the hydraulic gradient. And A is the cross-sectional area perpendicular to direction of flow and expressed in square meter. It's important to mention that the Darcy's law is valid when the flow is laminar, so no turbulence, when the soil is nearly saturated, and the flow is steady, so there's no time dependency. in that context, we usually consider as a steady state of cPage flow. The cPage will generate a pore water pressure in the soil. If we now take a look at Diana, how are we going to solve this problem? Basically, you need to perform a groundwater flow analysis, or let's say a potential flow analysis where the potential is the pore pressure potential phi. In Diana, you can perform two types of groundwater flow analysis. The steady state groundwater flow analysis, where you can consider a fully saturated state. Then we talk about, we usually name it the linear solution. And meaning that you have water everywhere, even in zones above the phreatic surface. The other case is a partially saturated one, or let's say the nonlinear solution. And in this state, pores can be partially filled. We talk them of saturation dependency. The second main type of groundwater flow is a transient groundwater flow. And in that case, your boundary condition can vary in time. But for today, we are going to stay in the steady state case. The general form of the groundwater flow equation is basically a diffusion equation, where C is stoactivity, K is hydraulic conductivity, and QV is a source or sink. In the case of a steady state analysis, this equation can be simplified since we do not consider the time dependency. So this term is not considered, and basically your equation is simplified to this. Typical groundwater flow outputs in Diana are the pore pressure potential phi, the pore pressure head phi p. We will use this output to actually determine the phreatic surface and the flux discharge q. In terms of boundary condition, you can consider three main classes. The essential one, also called Dirichlet, where you prescribe the potential. The natural one, also named Neumann, where the flux is prescribed. And a mixed one, also called Neumann-Robin, for which you need to use boundary elements. And this one we are going to use today in our case. So this is the case. How are we going to define the boundary condition of the cPage phase problem in Diana? We know that for the phreatic surface, the pressure head is null. But at the moment, we don't know yet the position of this cPage point S. This is what we are going to determine during the analysis. We also know that above this point, there's basically no flux running through the edge. So what we need to prescribe is a pressure head phi b here for this part of the edge. And we also need to define a groundwater flow boundary element, which is forming a resisting layer with a conductivity K along this edge. And through an iterative procedure, Diana will determine the correct boundary condition for the cPage phase and find this point S. We will see in more detail how to define this boundary condition in practice during the live demo. Before we start with the real case, it's good to know that for this problem, we can find an analytical solution. You can find it from the literature. So this is typically the problem. And the unknown is the position of this point S. From two ratios, L over H and H0 over H, with this graph, you can determine a point which will give you the ratio S over H. And from this ratio, you can determine this value S. So in our case, these two ratios are basically the length L over the potential 8, which gives roughly 0.5. And the other ratio, H0 over H, is basically this potential here over the other one. So it gives you this value. But you can report on this graph. And using the A value, you can come to this B value, which is your ratio S over H, from which you can compute an analytical value of 206. So let's see if we can come to a close solution, or close to this analytical value using Diana. Just before we really start with defining the model, maybe just a quick overview on the input data. So as you have seen, the model is a rectangular vertical cross section of 1.62 times 3.5 meter. At the side BC, it has a potential 8 of 3.22 meter. And on the other side, a potential 8 of 0.84 meter. We will try to determine the position of S, which will occur on this edge. The material has a saturated hydraulic conductivity of 1E-6 m/s, and an hydraulic conductivity which is pressure dependent is given on the following graph. So these are the main input for our model. So let's now start with the modeling. So this is the interactive window of Diana. I assume that most of you are now familiar with this window. So the first thing to do is, of course, to start a new project. And you do that by going to the File tab, New. So you need to define the name. I'm going to call it CPage Face. I'm going to save the file in a specific folder that I have for e-learning session. Then you need to select an analysis type. This choice will influence the option that will be available in the different menu. So here we choose for groundwater flow. For the dimension, we choose a generalized plane strain, which is also known as a complete plane strain assumption, to a pseudo-3D problem, which satisfies the following requirements. So every cross-section is a plane of symmetry for the geometry of the structure, and stresses and strains are independent of the coordinate along the out-of-plane axis. This concept is mainly used, and particularly used, for geotechnical problems. Next, you need to define the model size. This is basically the size of your modeling box, or the extreme dimension. So always pick up this size with special care, because make sure that your model can fit in this box. So today I'm going to use 100 meter, and I keep measure type as exaquad dominant. Because my model is in the XY plane, I also need to set the direction of the gravity. So I can do that by going to the reference system definition, and then go to property. And from here, you can change the gravity direction, and I'm going to set it to Y, so the vertical direction in my problem. Finally, in terms of units, we are going to use meter, kilogram, newton, second, kelvin, and radian. So we don't change anything here. So having defining the project settings and the units and the gravity direction, we can finally start the modeling, which you will see is pretty fast. We need to define this rectangle section. So to do that, I click on the add sheet. I'm going to call it section. And for the method, I'm going to use coordinate. I'm going to define the four corner points of this section plus one point on the edge where we have this 3.22 potential head. I already have an Excel sheet with the point coordinate, so I'm just going to copy this value. Here is my Excel sheet, so to save time, I have already entered the value. And I copy them here. I zoom out. You can see the four corner point plus the extra point here. And as I've already mentioned in previous webinars, do not forget to click the create button. So here we go. Now if I go to the geometry tree under shapes, I can see my section shape. So the geometry of the model is basically defined. We need now to set up the boundary condition, which is the main difficulty of this problem. So on one side, we need to apply a constant pressure head of 3.22 meter on the right side of the model. So we first need to fix the potential before we can prescribe it. So to do that, you click on the fix heads icon. You give it a name, so I'm going to call it fixed head at 3.22 meter. I'm going to use the same name set. For the field target type, I select age and I select this vertical edge. So by doing that, I tell Diana that I'm going to fix the potential on this edge. Then I click create. If I go to the geometry tab under fix potential, you can see that I have my condition here appearing. Now that we have fixed this potential, we need to prescribe the value. And to do that, you click on the attach groundwater boundary condition. For the name, we call it prescribed pressure head 322. We create a boundary set. Pressure head. The type is edge. It's a prescribed head of 3.22 meter. And then we select the edge where we want this value to be applied. And then we click create. And if I go under the boundary condition now on the left side, under pressure head, I can see this 3.22 prescribed head. This is for the right part of the model. On the left part, as I mentioned during my presentation, we need to apply a mixed condition. So we need to define the boundary elements. So we are going to start with that. So we click on the connection icon. For the name, I'm going to call it boundary. The connection type will be boundary interface. The type will be edge. And I select the vertical edge on the left side. The material class, we are going to set use groundwater flow boundary. And here we define the material I call boundaries. Groundwater flow, boundary element. And here we are going to give a conductivity of 0.0001. For the geometry, we also name it boundaries. It's a line type, it's groundwater flow element. And here we give it a thickness of 1 meter, which is basically the thickness of the plane strain element. This element have a unity thickness of 1 meter. And then we click create. So now we have under connection on the subfolder boundary interface our set of boundary elements. Still, we need to define the constant pressure head of 0.84 meter on this left-hand side. So we don't need to fix this condition. We just need to apply it. So we click on the groundwater boundary condition, name it pressure head of 0.84. It will be part of the pressure head set. Target type will be H. And here we use external head 0.84. And then I make sure that it's applied on the boundary by clicking on the boundaries, which are the boundary interface I have created. And I click on create. Finally, we need to give some material and physical property to our section. So we do that by clicking on the edit property assignment. I select all section. I'm going to use 2D groundwater flow element. For the material, I'm going to give it an in section. It's groundwater flow, it's isotropic. And there, I'm going to specify an hydraulic conductivity of 1E minus 6, stoichiometry 0. And for the hydraulic conductivity, as I mentioned, it's pressure head dependent. So I'm going to use a multilinear diagram. And I'm going to enter this diagram for which also the four value in an Excel sheet. So this is my diagram, which is the one, if I get back to my presentation, that I show in the last slide of my presentation. I click on close. Okay, so material is defined, and for the geometry of the section, it's 1 meter. And then you click on create. So we have defined our geometry. We have assigned our boundary condition, which in this specific case studies is, let's say, the critical point. We can now mesh our model. So to do that, I'm going to define some mesh seeding. So I'm going to use the shape type and the element size for the seeding method. I select the whole model, and I'm going to use a size of 0.14 meter. If I click on preview, you can see that the seeding is pretty regular, and I click apply. And then finally, I mesh, and I end up with a pretty regular hexadominant mesh. So the model is ready. We are going to move to the analysis part. As a preliminary analysis, we are going to perform a linear steady state analysis just to check that our model is correctly defined. So I click on the Add Analysis icon, right click, add comment, and I choose for the steady state converter flow. Here, not much to define, just use all the default. And the only thing we are going to tune is the result selection. So you edit the output block, and I'm going to, for the user selection, modify. Here I'm going to ask for the flux at integration point, and I'm going to ask for the total head and the pressure head. That's it. So model is complete, analysis is complete, so we can perform the analysis. And you can follow in the message box the progress. You see that the analysis is already done. It's not a big model, so it goes pretty fast. So we are going to look at the result of our linear analysis. So I go to the result tab. I expand the different result entity, and I'm going to present the total head H, and I will make a control plot of this. So you see that we find here a potential of 3.22 here on the right side. We can look at the flux, show as a vector. I'm going to tune so that you can see something. So if I click on the show view settings, I have access to a lot of options and parameter. So I go to the results tab for the vector plot, and the scaling factor I'm going to use 4, so that you can see the arrow, and I'm going to deactivate the boundary elements so that you can see the vector plot of the flux. What else can we look? We can look at the pressure head. And for this pressure head HP, you also see that the value 3.22 is there. Oops, sorry. Let me get back. Oops. So for the pressure head HP, I'm going to present the phreatic surface in terms of line. How I do that? So basically, I just do the show contour, but from the setting view, I need to do some manipulation. So first, I use control by default. It uses equidistant level. So this was the picture. So now if I go to the control level and I choose add specific value, plot the ISO surface at levels I check on, and then I only give value 0, so the one for which the pressure head is 0. I enter 0, and then I get my phreatic surface. You can see that in this case it's linear. Well, this is simply due to the fact that we perform a linear analysis. But in reality, this is a non-linear problem. So we are going to perform a non-linear steady-state analysis. So I'm going to duplicate my linear analysis. So far, it's analysis 2 is basically the same thing as analysis 1. But now we want to make it nonlinear, so we right-click on the execute Mongrater flow analysis block, and here you can choose the type. So it was linear, now we make it nonlinear. Boundary condition, we are going to use the pressure head, and for the first estimation of the potential field, we calculate it based on this pressure head. And we are also going to raise the number of iterations to 50. in term of output, I mean, output are still there, flux, pressure head, and total head. So this is how you make your analysis nonlinear. I'm now going to perform it. So this is done. Go back to the results, and now from the analysis, I can filter and go to analysis 2, which is my nonlinear case. Because Diana kept in memory the previous settings, and I'm showing the pressure head, you can see the immediately the phreatic surface of your model. And as highlighted before, to do that, you need to choose the option at specific value for the contour level. You specify only the value 0, and you ask to plot the isosurface level, and then you see the phreatic surface. If we want to know the value of this point S, we can use a measuring tool. And measure it, and we find that the elevation of S is at 2.129 meter. I remind you that the analytical value we found was 2.06. So let's say we find a value which is pretty close, which is not exactly the analytical solution, but the calculation seems to be quite accurate. But I want to raise to your attention that the theoretical solution or analytical solution assume a perfect separation between the saturated and unsaturated area. But in reality, and it's also what Diana does in the analysis, a partially saturated situation will occur just above the phreatic line. So due to this partly saturated area, the seepage point will be situated a little bit higher, and that's also what you see from the Diana analysis. So when you put all this information together, the result of the analysis is pretty good and pretty accurate. We can conclude by looking also at some other results, just for the fun of it. The main interest of this tutorial was to define the seepage point, and I think we come to a good result. We can look at the flux, show vector. I'm going to deactivate so you can see the flux, and you can also from the vector see that here is a phreatic phase. You have no flux above this phreatic phase, as I mentioned in my presentation. So this is a point S, and below this point you can see the flux, and above there's no flux. So this is also an interesting result. We can also look at the pressure head contour, and for that you need to get back to the equidistant level. And here you see the different contour of the pressure head. But definitely the most relevant is looking at the zero value to get the phreatic phase. And one more time, I'd like to thank you for following us and attending this webinar. And I hope to see you next time. Thank you. Have a good day. Bye.